to sell.
Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business today is First Minister's questions. And at question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On Saturday, a woman tragically died at a music festival on Skye. At the same festival, 27-year-old Ailey Beaton nearly lost her life when no ambulances were available. Ailey told the Press and Journal, "I was coming in and out of consciousness. My airways were shutting down. I could not breathe. At one point, I thought, if I don't get oxygen, I will not be here tomorrow." We spoke with Ailey last night, and she said this, "We were 200 yards from Portree Hospital. A local Coast Guard offered to carry me to the hospital, but we were told there was no point because it was closed. So I would just be left lying outside. One life has been lost, another was very nearly lost. Does John Swinney accept this should never have been allowed to happen?"
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I agree with Mr Ross, this should never have happened. I first of all want to express my sincere condolences to the family of the individual who lost their life. And I want to say to Ailey directly that I'm sorry for the experience, the terrifying experience that she had on Saturday night. As Mr Ross will be aware, Portree Hospital is not operating currently as a 24/7 emergency facility. Sir Lewis Ritchie recommended some years ago that it should be. And it is a matter of deep concern to the government that that has not happened. And the Health Secretary spoke with the leadership of NHS Highland yesterday to make it clear that we want that to happen at the earliest possible opportunity. And I want to say to the individuals who supported Ailey, also to the ambulance crews, the Portree ambulance was away from Portree at the time. Ambulances came to Portree from Dunvegan and from Kyle, which obviously involves, as Mr Ross will know, quite a travel time to get there. So those ambulances got there as quickly as possible. But I want to say to the individuals who supported Ailey, RNLI volunteers and others, the admiration and appreciation of the government for the steps they took to support an individual in our society.
Douglas Ross.
We all have admiration for those who stepped in to help, but it should never have got to that stage. And John Swinney says he has deep concern that the recommendations of the report have not been implemented. It's far worse than that. It is far worse than that. It's more than a few years ago, First Minister. It's 6 years ago, May 2018, this report was published. 6 years ago. This was an independent external review of out-of-hour health services in Skye, Lochalsh and the surrounding area. The very first recommendation, recommendation number one of this review from May 2018, says this: out-of-hours urgent care access at Portree Hospital should be provided 24/7. It also said there should be no closure of Portree Hospital in the out-of-hours period. It said the Scottish Ambulance Service should increase its paramedic staff capacity and capability in the region. But Ailey said this when we spoke to her last night. These are her words, First Minister. "The report has been on the table for 6 years saying that we need 24-hour urgent care. They keep making these promises, but delivering no action, making the same excuses." So why, in the last 6 years, have the recommendations of this independent report not been implemented?
First Minister.
I understand the genuine concern that Mr Ross is expressing to Parliament today, and I take that very seriously. But I have to point out, and Mr Ross is correct that this report came in 2018, but there has been a three-year period since then in which the 24/7 emergency care arrangements were provided at Portree Hospital, but they have not been able to be sustained because of workforce challenges in the locality. Now, I accept that is not good enough, which is why the Health Secretary has spoken to NHS Highland to insist that those arrangements must be put in place. But there is, of course, a challenge in relation to some of the workforce issues because of the availability of staff because of some of the issues in connection with availability of housing. And I would say to Mr Ross that there is ambulance cover available in Dunvegan, in Portree, and also in Kyle, and also, of course, at the Broadford Hospital. But I don't in any way want to say that that is good enough. The recommendations of Sir Lewis Ritchie must be implemented, and the Health Secretary has made that point directly and clearly to NHS Highland. But as a matter of fact, there was a three-year period where these recommendations were in force, but they haven't been able to be sustained because of workforce challenges.
Douglas Ross.
I don't think the First Minister, and I know he's not trying to do this, and he is treating this issue sensitively, as I think we all are, but it's no comfort to Ailey, who thought her airway was closing, who thought if she didn't get oxygen, that she may not see the next day. She will take absolutely zero comfort from the fact that in three of the last 6 years, there was 24/7 care, because when there was a major event in Skye, it wasn't available. And the First Minister says we will implement the recommendations of the report. Why are we hearing that now from the First Minister and from the Health Secretary, not when the report was published 6 years ago? And 6 years ago, the local MSP for the area, Kate Forbes, said the situation was utterly unacceptable and the out-of-hours closure was another step in the wrong direction. The Deputy First Minister said this week, enough is enough. It has been 6 years and the timescales for delivering the report recommendations keep shifting. This is the Deputy First Minister saying this. She added, there must be accountability. Well, we agree, but it's the SNP government in which she serves who need to be accountable. Kate Forbes was the Finance Secretary for years. She's now the Deputy First Minister, the second most powerful position in this government. But where was the will to act before now? It's not more empty words that are needed, it's action. So why does it take tragic events like we witnessed in Skye on Saturday for this government to finally step up and deliver?
First Minister.
I'm trying to be as helpful as I can on this question, but it is a matter of fact that Sir Lewis Ritchie's recommendations were implemented for a three-year period, but they haven't been sustained. Now, I accept that's not good enough, and that's what the government is addressing. That's why the Health Secretary has met directly in the last 48 hours with the leadership of NHS Highland. He's also met with Kate Forbes, the Deputy First Minister, and the Member of Parliament for Skye, Ross and Lochaber. So Skye, Lochaber and Badenoch, if I'm correct. So all of those conversations are taking place to ensure that the implementation of Sir Lewis Ritchie's recommendations are implemented, and they are implemented in short order. And I can give Mr Ross the assurance that the Health Secretary, myself as First Minister, will make sure that this issue is progressed. It should not have taken tragedies to get to this particular point, but I give Parliament the assurance that it has got the attention of ministers to ensure this is addressed promptly.
Douglas Ross.
Skye's health services were once again shown to be deficient at the weekend. Just last Friday, my colleague Jamie Halcrow-Johnson met with campaigners in Portree before these events happened, because local people and visitors were worried about the situation. They are still worried now, and they're right to be worried, because what we are getting is comforting words, but no sign of action. The action should have happened in 2018. It's as simple as that. We don't ask for independent external reviews and then say, well, they're implemented every now and then. They were required in 2018, and they were required for the entire six-year period since then, not just for 3 years. But the crisis across healthcare in rural Scotland is a concern to people up and down the country. As this incident has shown, there are black spots across Scotland where urgent treatment is often unavailable. There's sometimes no ambulances if you live in the wrong place. There is a postcode lottery for emergency care. This crisis is costing lives and putting people at risk. So what action will John Swinney take today to make sure everyone in Scotland, regardless of where they live, has the same access to the urgent health care they need and require.
First Minister.
President Officer, I do reiterate to Mr Ross that these recommendations were implemented, but they were found to be unable to be sustained. They were implemented for a three-year period, and I have accepted that that is not good enough and it has to be addressed, which is exactly what the Health Secretary is doing. I think it's important that I put on record what emergency care is available in Skye. There is an advanced nurse practitioner-led non-emergency appointments-based out-of-hours service in Portree Hospital, which is available by appointment on Saturdays and Sundays and bank holidays from 8:30 in the morning to 7:30 p.m. There is an A&E at Broadford Hospital, which is 30 minutes south of Portree, and in addition to that provision, the Scottish Ambulance Service has four double-crewed ambulances that cover Skye, based in Broadford, Portree, Dunvegan and Kyle. But there is a necessity for Sir Lewis Ritchie's recommendations to be implemented. That is exactly what the Health Secretary has insisted with NHS Highland will be undertaken, and that is what will happen. And we will update Parliament about the improvements that are delivered.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, after 17 years of this SNP government, the crisis in our NHS is deepening. Over 820,000 Scots are on an NHS waiting list. People who are waiting in pain are using their savings or borrowing money from loved ones to pay for private treatment. People can't get GP appointments, and 169,000 patients have waited more than 4 hours in A&E for treatment just since the start of this year. And now, because of this government's financial mismanagement, NHS and social care services face a black hole this year of up to £1.4 billion. That has led to the finance director of Greater Glasgow and Clyde, Scotland's biggest health board, to warn that spending in every service would need to be reviewed. Our NHS faces the biggest crisis in its lifetime, but health boards are being asked to make cuts across the country because of decisions made by John Swinney. So does he accept responsibility, and what is he going to do to fix the mess he made?
First Minister.
I think it's very important that we have a substantial discussion about the public finances and the context in which we are operating. We are now operating in Scotland after 14 years of austerity. Mm-hmm. That has put insufferable pressure on our public services. Mm-hmm. Now, within that, the National Health Service and health services in Scotland have been the best financially supported of any service within Scotland. So Anna Sarwar could come here today and he could ask me about financial pressures on local government. And he would be right, because there are financial pressures on local government. But he's raising with me financial pressures on the National Health Service, which has been the best funded part of our public services by this government. So I think in setting the context for Anna Sarwar's question to me, he and his colleagues have to understand that Scotland is now paying an intolerable price mm-hmm. for 14 years mm-hmm. of Westminster austerity.
Anna Sarwar.
So look, where John Swinney and I will not disagree is the fact that we need to get rid of a rotten Tory government that has destroyed the UK over the last 14 years. No disagreement on that. But after 17 years of government, always somebody else to blame, how about taking some responsibility for the decisions that are made here in Scotland? Now, the First Minister made no effort to address the scale of the crisis facing our NHS. Instead, he went to his get-out-of-jail-free card with the UK Tory government. His financial mismanagement and the £1.4 billion black hole that this has created will impact on the delivery of every service in every part of the country. And let's just look at announcements in the past few weeks. Inverclyde's out-of-hours GP service has been permanently closed, with patients now facing a 50-mile round trip to access overnight appointments. In the city of Glasgow alone, over 150 jobs have been lost in health and social care services. In North Ayrshire, care homes have been reduced and charges for vulnerable people have increased. And in Edinburgh, unions have warned that social care cuts will mean, in their words, thousands of hours of support will be cut. Hospitals, care homes, prison cells and morgues will fill up as a consequence. So stop passing the buck. Stop looking for somebody else to blame. John Swinney has been at the heart of this SNP government for 17 years. Isn't this a damning indictment of his record?
First Minister.
I will never evade the responsibility for my actions as a minister. Never. It's not in my character to do so. But I will be straight with Parliament and the public in Scotland. And what I've said, and people, if they want to go and look at all the things I've said on the parliamentary record over the last 17 years, they will find me being straight with people about the financial challenges we face. I also happen to have been a finance minister who's balanced the budget on 10 occasions over the last 17 years. And that has involved taking difficult decisions to protect our public services. That's resulted in the National Health Service being the best funded service in our public services. Now, we've also had to take some pretty tough decisions for which I take responsibility, such as increasing tax on higher earners. Mr. Sarwar has deserted that territory. Mr. Sarwar and Mr. Mara no longer believe in that territory. They voted for it once and they now condemn it. Well, how does Mr. Sarwar believe that we can invest as much as we invest in the health service today if we are not prepared to ask people to contribute more in taxation, which gives us £1.5 billion more in revenue at our disposal because of the decisions for which I am absolutely happy to take responsibility, because as a consequence of that, we can better fund the National Health Service than if we had relied simply on the financial settlement from the United Kingdom.
Anna Sarwar.
It demonstrates the economic incoherence of this First Minister, that he supports higher taxes for nurses, but lower taxes for oil and gas giants making record profits in the middle of a cost of living crisis. Now, our NHS is weaker than ever. Staff are under unbearable pressure and patients are being asked to accept the unacceptable, all because of the decisions made by this government. And as Deputy First Minister, John Swinney cut hundreds of millions of pounds from health and social care budgets. He said he doesn't want to evade responsibility for the decisions he made. So let me remind him of just one group of decisions he made in 1 year alone. He cut 70 million from social care while people were stuck in hospital, unable to get a care package. He cut 65 million from primary care services, making it difficult for people to get a GP appointment. He cut 38 million from mental health services, leaving people in crisis waiting longer to get the help they need. And he raided IJB budgets for over 300 million, the same local services that are facing funding gaps just now. So, John Swinney, don't evade responsibility. Stand up, apologise for the decisions you made, and recognise why people across Scotland are asking the question, how can the man that made the mess now be the one to fix it?
Always through the chair, Mr. Sarwar, First Minister.
I think it's a bit rich for Anna Sarwar to come here and to criticise me for decisions I've taken when he supports a party that wishes to relieve bankers of the obligation to pay into our tax system by lifting the cap on their bonuses. That is just a ludicrous position. Yeah. Now, I've listened this morning to the contribution from Keir Starmer in his setting out of Labour's policy position. I did not hear Keir Starmer setting out an uplift in public expenditure as a consequence of 14 years of austerity. I did not hear that this morning.
Let's hear the First Minister.
And lastly, in a situation where and Mr. Sarwar's accepted my point that austerity has been a curse in our society, but despite that austerity, resource funding for the National Health Service has more than doubled. Doubled since this government came to office in 2007. We've taken tough decisions to increase tax, to invest more in the National Health Service. We have given the National Health Service, made it the best supported financially of all the public services in Scotland, and we are absolutely committed to delivering for the National Health Service. But what Anna Sarwar cannot do is he cannot come here and deny that we have been operating in a significantly constrained public expenditure context, and we have delivered the best settlement we can for the National Health Service.
Question number three, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by expressing my party's condolences to the family of Heather Ed, who died after becoming unwell at the Sky Live Music Festival last weekend. I also want to thank those who attended her and Ailey Beaton, who, as we've heard, also became unwell. To ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
First of all, Presiding Officer, let me associate myself with the comments that Mr. Cole-Hamilton has made about Heather Ed and Ailey Beaton. The Cabinet will next meet on Tuesday.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, the emergency care system collapsed on Sky last weekend. Ailey Beaton's life-threatening anaphylactic shock happened virtually on the doorstep of Portree Hospital. 5 EpiPens administered to keep her alive. Lifeboat volunteers hammering on the doors. Her boyfriend literally threw rocks at the windows of the hospital, all because the doors were locked. For 6 years, the government has known about the Ritchie report. 6 years, and the doors were still locked. And Sky isn't alone in the hollowing out of rural healthcare. Just ask the mums who have to drive 100 miles down the treacherous A9 in labour because their local maternity unit in Caithness was closed. The day before the emergency on Sky, I was in the Highlands. I called on the new First Minister directly, again, to get the Portree Hospital open for emergency care. We keep asking. This isn't news to him. Why has it taken 6 years and a near fatality for his government to finally lift the phone to NHS Highland about emergency care on Sky?
First Minister.
I've gone through with Douglas Ross, but I'll go through again for Mr. Cole-Hamilton some of the issues and provisions that are in place. The circumstances at the weekend were unacceptable, and the recommendations of Sir Lewis Ritchie should have been implemented consistently over the last 6 years. They were implemented for 3 of the last 6 years. That's not good enough. It certainly wasn't good enough at the weekend. So that issue has been addressed directly by the Health Secretary in his dialogue with NHS Highland. Now, Mr. Cole-Hamilton raises other issues about the maternity care in Caithness. As Mr. Cole-Hamilton will understand, we take direct clinical advice about the sustainability of clinical services, and I think it would be inappropriate for the government not to take seriously the clinical advice that we have about the sustainability and effectiveness of local services, and that will always be a priority for the government. But I want to make it clear to Parliament the importance that the government attaches, hence the point I've just made to Mr. Sarwar, about the significance of the financial settlement that we give to the National Health Service to make sure that the resources are deployed effectively around the country to ensure we have effective public services and effective health services to be available. That's the direction of the government's healthcare policy. That is what we will do and what we will implement on behalf of the people of Scotland.
Question number 4, Evelyn Tweed.
Sir. To ask the First Minister what steps the Scottish Government is taking to raise awareness of the issue of sextortion in light of the recent issuing of an urgent warning by the National Crime Agency to education providers across the UK.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, keeping children and young people safe from sexual abuse and exploitation, including sextortion, is a priority for the Scottish Government. We welcome the efforts of the National Crime Agency to raise awareness of this serious harm. We are also raising awareness of the risk of sextortion and have provided information to parents and carers on the Parent Club website, which is currently being promoted via social media. Police Scotland are also updating sextortion resources on their website to reflect the new NCA guidance. We will continue to work closely with national and UK partners, including the Internet Watch Foundation, Police Scotland, the National Cyber Security Centre, and the Cyber and Fraud Centre Scotland to tackle cybercrime, including sextortion scams.
Evelyn Tweed.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. Murray Dowie from Dunblane tragically took his own life in December after falling victim to sextortion via Instagram. This young man, with his whole life ahead of him, was just 16 years old. Murray's loss is felt very widely in the community, and many are asking how they can protect young people online. Can the First Minister outline the steps the Scottish Government can take to ensure social media sites take the safeguarding of young people seriously, and where things go wrong, cooperate fully with the authorities?
First Minister.
Can I thank Evelyn Tweed for raising this important case? And I have watched with incredible admiration the courage of Roz and Mark Dowie in talking about their beloved son, Murray. And I cannot, as the parent of a teenager, comprehend the scale of loss, the unimaginable suffering that they are experiencing. But I commend their bravery in raising the awareness of the threat of sextortion, which has had such a terrible impact on their family. The Government will continue to prioritise working closely with national and UK partners to protect children and young people from sexual abuse and exploitation through our membership of Police Scotland's multi-agency group on preventing online child sexual abuse. Ministers in the Government will be meeting with the Ofcom board member for Scotland in the coming weeks to discuss the implementation of the important legislation on online safety, which has been taken forward by the United Kingdom Government, in which we have been, as a Government, deeply engaged. And we must all take the efforts we can to raise awareness of this important issue to ensure that families and young people are supported with these threats that are now in existence in our society. So let me say to Evelyn Tweed that I commend the bravery of Roz and Mark Dowie. They have my deepest sympathy for the loss that they have experienced and the commitment of my Government to do all that we can to protect young people from crimes such as sextortion and the incalculable suffering that can inflict on families in our country.
Question number 5, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, in light of the Clyde and Hebrides ferries contract expiring in September, when the Scottish Government will publish the tender process for the new contract?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's priority is to ensure provision of a high-quality service to communities on the Clyde and Hebrides route. As stated in Parliament on the 16th of November, the Cabinet has agreed that, subject to a satisfactory due diligence exercise, the next generation of the Clyde and Hebrides ferry service provision could be awarded via a TECAL exemption to the incumbent Calmac Ferries Limited. If an award via TECAL exemption is confirmed to be the procurement route for the next service provision, a tender process will not be required. Should there be an unsatisfactory outcome from the due diligence work, then we would revert to a competitive tendering process. An update on the preferred procurement route will be provided before the summer recess.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, First Minister. Of course, that is in direct contravention of what Islanders wanted and told the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. And I'm surprised that the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, who took evidence as part of that committee, has not briefed the First Minister about this. Would the First Minister consider the decision as to give this contract to a company whose parent company made a £60 million profit from delivering poor services in 2022-23 would be against the wishes of the islanders?
First Minister.
Well, the first thing I would say is that I've heard Edward Mountain before commending the contribution of my colleague Fiona Hislop, the Transport Secretary, to the report of the Net Zero Committee. Indeed, I seem to recall him speaking so warmly about it that he wondered if he'd damaged Ms Hislop's political career and prospects. But it was appropriate commendation, which is why Fiona Hislop is the Cabinet Secretary for Transport and undertaking her responsibilities extremely well. We listen carefully to the views of island communities and we will continue to do so. I give that assurance to Mr Mountain. As a regular user of the Clyde and Hebrides ferry services, which I am, and they are very precious to me, I will listen carefully to the views not just of my Transport Secretary but also of islanders to understand the need for them to have access to a high-quality service that will meet their needs both as residents and as businesses and to accommodate visitors accessing our islands.
Brief supplementary, Katie Clark.
Does the First Minister accept that it's now too late to go to tender, so irrespective of the outcome of the due diligence process, that it will be necessary for CalMac to continue to provide the service after September and that it's only fair to let them know that as soon as possible?
First Minister.
As I said in my original answer to Mr Mountain, the update on the procurement route will be given before the summer recess, which will provide the clarity that Katie Clark reasonably asks for and which will give certainty to island communities at that period.
Jackie Dunbar.
So, my understanding is that the consultation ran for 12 weeks and closed in early March. Does the First Minister share my view that the voices and views of islanders and other ferry-dependent communities must be central to this process, which is why it is vitally important that the Scottish Government takes the required time to study the responses and fully appreciate what it is being told?
First Minister.
So that dialogue is essential, as also is the dialogue with the Ferries Community Board, who shapes significantly the dialogue that the Government takes forward on these important questions. And I give Jackie Dunbar the assurance that we will take the necessary time to ensure that all of these issues are properly explored before final decisions are taken.
Jamie Green.
Whether it's a direct award or a tender, the last tender process was little more than a beauty parade with an inevitable outcome. So before we hand it on a plate to Carmack again, can we make sure they deliver on the 350 overt commitments that it made last time it won this contract, of which more than 30 are yet to be delivered?
First Minister.
I am very much in favour of making sure that in these contract arrangements, the expectations of communities are met. That's what ministers will insist upon, to ensure that we have a high quality, reliable service for island communities, and I'm committed to make sure that's the case.
Question number 6, Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister whether he will provide an update on any risks presented by whooping cough in Scotland in light of reports of increased infection rates and infant deaths in the UK.
First Minister.
So I'm sure that Parliament will share my concern at the tragic loss of 5 young lives that have been reported in the media as a consequence of whooping cough. These deaths occurred in England. However, Public Health Scotland have confirmed that notifications of whooping cough or pertussis in Scotland have increased since the beginning of the year, and laboratory-confirmed cases are likely to rise in line with this. Pertussis is spread by respiratory droplets, either directly between people or through contaminated items. Young, unimmunised children and babies are particularly at risk of severe illness. The infection can be prevented by immunisation. I would encourage parents to ensure that younger children and infants are immunised. Pregnant women should also receive the vaccine, which provides vital protection for the first few weeks of their baby's life.
Bob Dorris.
I thank the First Minister for that answer, and he's right that tragically in England 5 babies have died from whooping cough after a surge in infection rates there. And I think the First Minister just confirmed that similar surge is already underway in Scotland. However, vaccination, of course, can protect babies, pregnant mothers, and importantly, their unborn children also. Worryingly, uptake for infant vaccinations appears to have fallen in recent times, and babies from the most deprived areas, including parts of my constituency, Maryhill and Springburn, are less likely to be vaccinated. Will the First Minister work with NHS boards right across Scotland to ensure every effort is made to support midwives, health visitors and local vaccination teams to maximise uptake at this crucial time, as well as considering how our NHS can take steps to address the dip in vaccine rates more generally right across Scotland?
First Minister.
I completely understand the concern that Mr Dorris brings to Parliament today, and the immunisation pathway is the most reliable way to protect babies in the early weeks of their life. The Chief Midwifery Officer is writing to maternity services to encourage and promote pertussis vaccination for pregnant women to do exactly as Mr Dorris has asked me to commit to. And I will encourage the Chief Midwifery Officer to support the awareness-raising efforts that are essential to ensure that these services are delivering that message to pregnant mothers and to ensure that vaccination uptake is taken forward. We all know the importance of vaccination efforts, and I give Mr Dorris the commitment that the Health Service will follow exactly the approach that he suggested to Parliament today.
Supplementary, Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As has been said, the statistics from England and Wales show that the uptake in immunisation against whooping cough during pregnancy has reduced quite sharply. And as the First Minister has indicated, this is so important in expectant mothers. I'm wondering if we know if that trend has continued, is similar in Scotland. You have mentioned some of the relevant response to the possibility of this, but I wondered if you might be able to work with Public Health Scotland to ensure that these specific uptake statistics are public in order that we can properly scrutinise the uptake by pregnant mothers?
First Minister.
Senator, I'll explore the point that Carol Mockin puts to me. The data I have on immunisation uptake from Public Health Scotland, which was published on the 26th of March, indicates in relation to some vaccinations an increase in uptake, but from the information I have, I don't think that's specific about pertussis. So I'll give Carol Mockin a specific answer. But generally on immunisation, the uptake is moving in the right direction, which we would all want to see. But I will need to provide a specific answer on pertussis, which I'll do in the aftermath of First Minister's questions.
Question number 7, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the First Minister, in light of reports that only 4 homes have been approved nationally under the Affordable Housing Initiative for Key Workers Scheme, whether he will provide an update on what efforts will be made to address the housing crisis in rural and island areas.
First Minister.
So, from April 2016 to March 2023, we have delivered more than 10,000 homes in rural and island areas. We're working with local authorities and registered social landlords to encourage utilisation of the £25 million Key Workers Homes Fund where there are identified local requirements. I'm pleased that there are currently 3 local authorities who are actively looking to bring forward proposals in rural communities. We will invest nearly £600 million in affordable homes across Scotland this year, including significant investment in rural and island areas through our mainstream affordable housing supply programme, as well as our demand-led Rural and Islands Housing Fund and Rural Affordable Homes for Key Workers Fund.
Rhoda Grant.
I have spoken to NHS Highland on numerous occasions about health service in Portree Hospital in the Isle of Skye. Each time I do, they come back to me saying they can recruit, but the people they recruit cannot find a home and they cannot take up the post. Therefore, he'll understand my concern that the £25 million government fund to provide key worker housing has only bought 4 homes. What is wrong with the scheme? Why is it not working? Will he personally take matters into his own hands, fully implement the recommendations of Sir Lewis Ritchie's report? And will he ensure that those key workers have homes to live in Skye?
First Minister.
I share the aspirations that Rhoda Grant has put to Parliament today. NHS Highland have a close working relationship with Lochalsh and Skye Housing Association, and they've supported NHS Highland in providing housing for key staff in Broadford. There are 4 flats that have been leased for nurses, 3 of which are supporting the International Recruitment Project, which brings skills into the locality to meet some of the shortages that we are experiencing. And the remaining flat is used for on-call staff. The board also leases 2 family homes for specialist staff located at the new Broadford Hospital. All houses and flats in that development are fully occupied. So I hope that gives Rhoda Grant reassurance that where these projects come forward, they are fully utilised and deployed. What I would say is that there is an invitation to public bodies to come forward with the proposals to access the fund. The fund has not been fully utilised, so I would encourage public authorities from this podium to come forward with their bids to address some of the issues that Rhoda Grant raises, because the issues that Rhoda Grant raises are underpinned the issues that Mr Ross has raised with me today and Mr Cole Hamilton about having accommodation available for staff in rural areas. I do acknowledge that as a problem. My long-term leadership of the Convention of the Highlands and Islands over many years in government taught me that important lesson about the interconnectedness of housing, and I would encourage public authorities to come forward with the measures that will address these issues.
Alistair Allen.
Access to affordable housing remains one of the key factors driving depopulation in our islands. There has been significant Scottish Government investment in recent years, but can the First Minister say more about the Scottish Government's approach to working with key stakeholders to ensure empty homes are brought back into use and that enough new homes are being built in both rural and urban areas of the Highlands and Islands?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I do recognise the issue, the importance of good quality affordable housing in rural and island communities to address some of the public service delivery challenges that exist. This is an issue that Dr Allen and I have discussed on many occasions in our in taking forward issues in relation to the islands. We are working to increase the supply of affordable housing in rural and island areas. There's a £3.7 million investment in the Scottish Empty Homes Partnership, which is making a real difference, with more than 9,000 homes brought into use since 2010. Now, I want to see all local authorities and all partners working together to consider all available options. The government will be very much part of that discussion, and the Housing Minister, Paul McLennan, who's listening to these exchanges, will take forward that issue as a priority to ensure that we address the challenges that exist in many of the communities that Dr Allen represents.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A Freedom of Information request has revealed that SNP ministers have no idea how many houses will be built in Scotland in coming years. Under the Scottish Government's National Planning Framework, we now see record low levels of land coming forward in the development pipeline. So can I ask the First Minister, what urgent steps will ministers take to review the Scottish Government's National Planning Framework? And also, why are ministers being so slow to take forward permitted development rights to build new homes in rural and island communities?
First Minister.
I think Mr Briggs needs to be aware of the government's record on housing, because...
Oh, that's brave.
Members, let's hear the First Minister.
Okay, well, let's have a look at the data. I'm all for helpfully bringing data to Parliament to help inform parliamentary proceedings. It's part of my commitment to open government. Since 2007, Scotland has seen 40% more affordable homes delivered per head of population than in England, and 70% more than in Wales. I'll repeat that so that everyone can hear it. 40% more affordable homes delivered per head of population in Scotland than in England, 70% more than in Wales. And Scotland's overall new house build completion rate in 22-23 increased to 43 homes per 10,000 people. That was higher than Wales at 18 and higher than England at 38. So the government is determined to ensure that we put the resources in place, activate the private investment to ensure that we deliver the houses for people, because this government's got a formidable record on housing construction, which we are proud to proclaim to the people of Scotland.
Thank you. We will move to constituency and general supplementaries, and I call Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This week, the Secretary of State for Scotland confirmed that planning is underway to develop new nuclear reactors in Scotland, despite opposition.
Let's hear Ms Mackay.
Despite opposition from the democratically elected Scottish Government. Scotland doesn't need expensive nuclear power. We already have abundant natural energy resources. Can the First Minister advise if the UK Government has approached Scottish ministers about these apparent plans? And can he confirm that the Scottish Government will oppose these plans and instead have Scotland's substantial renewable energy potential?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm often lectured in this Parliament about the importance of good intergovernmental relations. The Secretary of State for Scotland has made no mention of this proposal to the Scottish Government. This is utterly and completely incompatible with good intergovernmental working, and it's illustrative of the damaging behaviour, the menacing behaviour of the Secretary of State for Scotland.
Absolutely.
The Scottish Government will not support new nuclear power stations in Scotland. I was in Ardazir on Monday. The Net Zero Secretary was in Nigg on Tuesday, supporting the announcements of formidable investments in the renewable energy potential of Scotland. Massive investments that will bring jobs and opportunities to the Highlands and Islands and deliver green, clean energy for the people of Scotland. That's the policy agenda of this government, and we'll have nothing to do with nuclear power.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yet another crash at the notorious Tullibarness last week resulted in 4 people in hospital and the road closed for hours. Promises to upgrade this junction date back to before 2007, when Alex Salmond said his first decision, if elected as First Minister, would be to deal with this road. 17 years on, promise broken, continued carnage. Will the new SNP First Minister deliver on the promises that all previous SNP First Ministers have broken?
First Minister.
I'll happily take forward the issues that Mr Kerr has raised with me today. The government, of course, has an infrastructure programme which is taking forward developments around the country. I'll look at the particular project that Mr Kerr has put to me and consider the position of that project within the government's capital programme.
Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Board papers have revealed the Scottish Government have demanded £54 million of cuts in this financial year from NHS Tayside. Officers have presented the board with options. The removal of 3 operating theatres in a ward, that would mean 3,000 additional people missing out on vital operations this year. Another option is the end of breast cancer screening in a department that has been in crisis for years, resulting in an inevitable decline in detection and the loss of life. Which should they choose, First Minister? Or will you act to ensure that these consequences do not fall on your constituents and mine?
Always through the chair, First Minister.
Presiding Officer, Mr Mara raises important issues about the sustainability of health service provision, and the government has to live within the financial resources available to it. Now, it's just ludicrous, actually, for Mr Mara to come here and demand, I've went through with Mr Sarwar, the fact that the health service is the best funded part of our public services. It occupies a larger proportion of our budget than it did when this government came to office. So when this government came to office in 2007, health service expenditure accounted for about 30% of our total budget. That is now much closer to 50%. So the government has substantially increased expenditure on health. To fund that, we have increased tax on higher earners. Mr Mara is opposed to that. Yes. Mr Mara wants to make the situation worse. Mr Mara wants to reduce the amount of revenue that's available, but he wants me to fund more public services. Mr Mara can't have his cake and eat it.
Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's Mental Health Awareness Week, and the theme is moving more for our mental health. We all know how important exercise can be for mental health, so the Scottish Government's recent investment of a further £100,000 in the football-focused mental wellbeing changing room programme is very welcome. Can the First Minister say what other steps the Government is taking to support mental wellbeing and resilience in the community?
First Minister.
Officer, the first thing I'd say is that there is an importance where we can for us all to take our own responsibility and to look after ourselves. So this morning at 6 o'clock, I was running through the streets of Edinburgh to support my own mental well-being, because I tend to find that I have a better time at First Minister's questions if I've run in the morning than if I've not run in the morning. So members will be able to tell whether I've been out running in the morning or not on a weekly basis. Mr. MacGregor raises a very significant issue. Through our community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund for Adults, we've made available £66 million for community projects since 2021. The fund, which supported approximately 300,000 people across Scotland in its first year, is focused on addressing a number of mental health and wellbeing concerns within local communities in Scotland. There will be, since 2020, we've also made available £65 million to local authorities to develop community support projects, and the government remains committed to doing the work and supporting the work that Mr McGregor raises to assist in this respect. And on the Changing Room programme, the Health Secretary was in Aberdeen yesterday to launch this programme, and it's a welcome contribution to our efforts on mental health and wellbeing.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is a member's business debate in the name of Martin Whitfield, and there will now be a short suspension to allow those leaving the chamber and public gallery to do so before the next item begins.